Hello, welcome to The Baby Historian. This week's video is another primary source reading. This is a chapter from Mrs. Thomas Little's Domestic Institutes of Young Mothers, published in 1824. The chapter is the advice for self-care during pregnancy from Mrs. Little's friend, the late Sir Richard Croft, a royal physician and an accoucheur, a man midwife. Sir Croft attended Princess Charlotte during her first labor, which resulted in the triple obstetric tragedy, in which two generations of heirs to the British throne died. Charlotte's son was stillborn after 50 hours of labor, and then she died while recovering. And then Sir Croft himself committed suicide the following year. As always, I produce these read-alongs to help more people get involved with primary source material, and nothing contained in these primary sources, and this one is nearly 200 years old, should be taken as medical or dietary advice. Please, do not drink a bottle of claret daily for 6 to 7 months during pregnancy. Domestic Institutes of Young Mothers by Mrs. Thomas Little, to which are prefixed Instructions for Self-Management During Pregnancy by the late Sir Richard Croft, Baronet, M.D., 3rd edition, London, J.J. Stockdale, 24 Opera Colonnade, 1824, price 1 shilling 6 pence. We'll be reading Chapter 1. Chapter 1, Self-Management During Pregnancy, What May Prevent Impregnation, Monthly Discharges, Ailments Consequent on Pregnancy, Quickening. Early marriage is generally advisable, but it frequently happens that a female is suddenly taken, as it were, from the nursery to be placed at the head of a family, having had little or no opportunity to become acquainted either with the duties attendant on such a situation, or even with what is required for her personal management in the most anxiously desired and delicate circumstances. The transition from the greatest regularity under the vigilant eye of maternal anxiety, where every care is shown, even to the most trivial occurrences, and from, perhaps, the plainest diet, to a sumptuously provided table, of which she is the chiefest ornament and attraction, makes unreasonable the expectation that she shall not partake in the rich viands which are placed before her, or refuse the pressing entreaties to drink wine with her numerous guests, all of which feel personally desirous of sharing that honor with the youthful bride. High living, especially if combined with late hours, frequently prevents impregnation, but where due care is observed as to diet, cleanliness, air, exercise, and the general health and management, should pregnancy not occur for a considerable length of time, the cause may be sought for in the formation of the female organs, as adverted to in, quote, The Beauty of the Sexes, unquote, page 44, volume 2, and a graphical delineation of which is contained in the 5th edition of, quote, Dr. Robertson's Generative System, quote, by Little. Females are too apt to neglect due precautions at those particular recurring periods, when all violent exercise and exposure to damp and cold should be avoided, and a close underdress be put on. Every call of nature should become a regular habit. From false notions of delicacy in that respect, serious consequences have frequently resulted. These are important considerations at all times, but more particularly during pregnancy, when retention of urine may be productive of serious inconvenience. Married ladies should always note the periods when certain changes have been customary, the non-appearance of which affords rational supposition that pregnancy may be the cause of it, though that is far from certain. Cases are not unknown where ladies have been regular in those changes even to the time of delivery. After pregnancy has taken place, the womb is sometimes so irritable that it is absolutely necessary that further intercourse should be suspended or miscarriage will ensue. Where local irritation is produced by intercourse, it will sometimes be mitigated, if not subdued, by profuse lavation of the parts with cold water. But the sure remedy is introducing a suppository of 2 or 3 grains of opium or 4 or 5 grains of extract of hemlock, which will not disturb the constitution so much as when taken into the stomach. This irritability seldom recurs after the birth of a child, though instances to the contrary are not rare. The most common irritations which attend pregnancy are sickness and pains in the breast, back, and face, also the heartburn. But these generally decrease as pregnancy advances, and those who suffer most during pregnancy are least liable to miscarry and have the finest children, though not always the easiest labors. When retchings are very violent, breakfasting in bed, being much in the open air, eating water ice, frequently lying on the back or the application of laudanum or an opium plaster or ointment to the pit of the stomach will often allay them. 10 grains of magnesia and 10 drops of spirits of hartshorn mixed in 2 tablespoons full of cold water will often counteract the violence of the disposition. Or, should it become excessive, 5 to 10 drops of laudanum may be taken every 6 hours, or 4 to 6 ounces of blood may be extracted from the arm. The pains in the breast may be generally assuaged by rubbing them with laudanum and sweet oil, but though pain in the face may be removed by applying ice to it externally, it will often only give way to considerable doses of laudanum. A plaster of the white of an egg beaten up with a tablespoon of laudanum thickened with flour and applied to the loins every night will generally keep off the pains in the back, but the horizontal position is most to be depended on. When the slightest color attends these pains, it should be regarded as an indication of miscarriage, and 10 drops of laudanum be instantly taken. Besides having recourse to the external application of opium, and perfect quiet in the horizontal position until medical aid can be obtained. When walking induces pain in the back, the air should be obtained without exercise, either in an open carriage or by sitting out of doors. The copious use of cold water and dashing a basinful on the back night and morning, or taking a cold or shower bath every other morning, is a preventative of this pain. The heartburn will sometimes give way to chewing green tea, but this generally depends on what immediately causes it. A relaxed state of the bowels is not favorable to pregnancy, and costiveness is, not infrequently, one of the first symptoms of that state. When the bowels do not act spontaneously, once in 48 hours, lukewarm or even cold water may be safely used as lavation, whenever the necessity may occur. Miscarriages are generally accompanied by a relaxed state of the bowels, unless when the effect of accident or alarm. Should 5 to 10 drops of laudanum taken every 4 or 6 hours not allay this relaxation, 50 drops and about 3 tablespoons full of starch or arrowroot gruel, as lavation rarely fails. A pill of 1 or 2 grains of pure opium introduced into the rectum, and which may be repeated night and morning if necessary, will produce equal effect. Piles and irritation of the bladder are very common during pregnancy. Those evils may be prevented or even cured by frequent lavations of cold water or its application in a sponge, and the latter will be allayed by a teaspoonful of sweet spirit of nitre taken twice or thrice a day in a cup of barley water with gum arabic dissolved in it. When very troublesome, 10 drops of laudanum may be added to each dose of nitre. If the veins of the legs and thighs become varicose and much dilated, they should be supported by a roller, and a great temperance of living be observed. The general irritability of the body is much increased by pregnancy, and may be diminished by warm flannel clothes, by taking as much air as possible, and by the copious use of cold water. Sea air and bathing tend more to the diminution of their irritability than anything else we know of. Quickening generally takes from 14 to 20 weeks after the last regular period. It is frequently accompanied by fainting, which may be treated, as at any other time, by exposure to fresh air or administering wine or volatile spirits in water. Giddiness is far from uncommon in pregnancy and may be relieved by a camphor mixture, with or without ether or a sol volatile. High living or eating animal food or eggs more than once a day encourages this affection, but it will sometimes be suspended or removed by a spontaneous discharge of blood from the nose. On these occasions, opening medicines, bleeding, and more abstemious diet should be enjoined, and all fermented liquors should be relinquished. Symptoms of fullness in the head and consequent giddiness and pain are very apt to prevail when a pregnant lady becomes corpulent and appears more florid and in fuller health than usual. If her pulse be slow, bleeding in the arm will increase its activity and relieve the uncomfortable sensations of the head. Exercise is by no means indispensable during pregnancy, but those who can take it without fatigue or other inconvenience should live as much as possible in the open air, carefully avoiding, however, whatever may produce pain in the back. Violent exertion, particularly overreaching at anything above the head, may bring a labor at any period of pregnancy, and wherever it takes place prematurely, the chance of a favorable termination is diminished. When disinclination to sleep accompanies pregnancy, getting out of bed and taking a few turns up and down the room will often remedy it. Ladies who have been subject to miscarriage should consider themselves pregnant on passing their first period, and thenceforth carefully avoid all violent exertion of the body and mind, large parties, heated rooms, and late hours. Though high living should be generally discountenanced during pregnancy, yet where the appetite is not good and becomes capricious, it is better to indulge than thwart it. The treatment must be adapted to the constitution. Some ladies cannot get through their pregnancy except by living wholly on vegetables without a particle of animal food, while others will drink a bottle of claret daily for 6 to 7 months together. The preceding observations are almost wholly by the author's esteemed and lamented friend, Sir Richard Croft, Baronet, and, as well as those which follow, have been confirmed by the personal experience of the writer, who indulges in no speculative theory, but confines herself entirely to the result of practice and that in her own family. Thank you for watching. If you have enjoyed, please like and subscribe. And if you would like to read more of this book, you can find it on archive.org. The link will be in the description. And if you would like to support the Baby Historian, become a patron on Patreon. The link will also be in the doobly-doo. Have a great day!